Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Clementine Complex by Bob Mortimer. Read by the author and Sally Phillips.
Hello, Bob Mortimer here. Just wanted to explain that The Clementine Complex was first published in the UK as The Satsuma Complex. In the UK, miniature tangerines are known as Satsumas, whereas they are more often, I'm told, called Clementines in the States, hence the change for the North American publication. What you're about to hear is my original recording of the book. Although the title has been changed, you will hear me say Satsuma throughout this audiobook rather than Clementine. And please bear in mind that the cover of the UK version had a great big Satsuma or Clementine right in the middle of the cover. Otherwise, the American and UK editions are the same. Thank you, hope you enjoy the book. Part 1, Chapter 1. My name is Gary. I'm a 30-year-old legal assistant with a firm of solicitors in London. I live by myself in a one-bedroom flat on a sprawling 1960s local authority housing estate in Peckham. My flat is just a five-minute walk from work, a state of affairs that pleases me on those occasions that I wish it to. I'm on the short side of average height and come equipped with a large nose that borders on the comical if I wear sunglasses. If you happen to clock me in the street, I will invariably be wearing my cheap grey suit with a white shirt and tie, work days, or my brown corduroy jacket with jeans and a t-shirt, empty days. There's a good chance you might see my nose before you spot my clothing. My hair is neat and tidy with a short back and sides and a side parting engineered to resemble a semi-quiff. My brown eyes are almond-shaped and have been described as both sad and welcoming within the same 24 hours. To describe me as anonymous would be unfair, but to notice me other than in passing would be a rarity. My only real friend in London is one of my neighbours on the estate. I did make a good connection with a girl this past week or so, but earlier today that blew up in my face and smacked my ass with a fish slice. I thought she liked me, but it turned out I was very wrong. I think I was in love with her. In fact, I'm sure I was. And being honest, I still am. I'm properly heartbroken for the first time in my life. My mum used to tell me that I was blessed with a good imagination and should use it to my advantage, to relieve any boredom and inject perspective and joy into me life. She would say, if you can imagine something that has never happened to you, then when you encounter it, you will be better prepared to appreciate and cope with it. Sadly, my imagination is not really working to my benefit at the moment, though to be fair to Mum, it usually does. Some people bury their faces in their smartphones all day, but not me. I've had the same old Nokia phone for years and years and have never bothered with social media and the like. I don't see the point of it. I've got enough strangers in my life as it is. So if I'm out and about, I keep my head up and my mind stimulated by the sights and sounds around me. Neighbours arguing. I might imagine it's over the need to replace a washing machine filter. A broken window. I imagine it was smashed by a child manoeuvring an adult ladder. Rust penetrating the wheel arches of a long abandoned car. I imagine the car has been dumped by a wine merchant that went nuts. Dogs sharing an interest in a spillage. I imagine the dogs are called Zack Briefcase and Lengthy Parsnips. If these sights and thoughts aren't stimulated enough, I let my imagination kick into a higher setting. For example, when I'm walking to work, I have to wind through the various access roads that meander between the blocks of low and high-rise flats on my estate. Just before the exit from the estate is a grassed play area about the size of half a football pitch. There used to be a seesaw, but I heard it was removed because some kid smashed up her face really badly on it. You don't often see any small kids using the area, probably on account of the cumulative dog dirting. Come to think of it, you don't see many young kids anywhere on the estate. They must be there, but you just don't see them. Often, as I pass by this grassy patch, a squirrel will stop in its tracks and stand up on its back legs to have a good nose at me. All right, mate, I whisper to myself. Your tail is looking well plump and very high. Have you got something special on today? Oh, thanks, Gary, I reply on his behalf. Nothing special. I've met this lady that I like and I'm trying to look my best. You should give it a try. You're looking a right mess if you don't mind me talking around that fact. I'm just going to buy a pie, no need to dress up for that. What if you meet a beautiful lady at the pie shop? You wish you'd thought a bit more around what you look like. You'd think about me and say to yourself, that lad was well prepared. He'd covered a lot of bases that I haven't even started to address. Yeah, maybe that could happen, I reply. Thanks for the tip. So where did you meet this new lady of yours? You know what? It was exactly where you're standing. She was stood stock still, just like you, singing a song about the Royal Mail or a cruise ship, something like that. It was hard to tell because her singing was so shit. But when I thought around how pretty she was, I was very impressed. Well, you seem happy, and I have to say you're looking the business. Yeah, things are looking up, and I've got a good feeling about your prospects too. You should buy some cologne, or at least think around doing something like that. I can smell romance in the air. I might just do that. I'll see you around. I walk on with a spring in my step and a good connection in my account. The idea of romance is often a good source of hope for me. I'm sure a lot of people have these little daydreams and flights of fancy to fill the passing of time, but I don't know if they realise how important they can be to inject a bit of balance and optimism into your life. I need a lot of that just now, especially given that, on the face of it, my life is bordering on the shit. I'm in my car driving to a meeting with a bloke called John McCoy. The prospect fills me with panic and dread. It's a make-or-break meeting for me and I just want it to be over and done with. At the moment I'm being held up by a bloke who spilled a huge bag of onions on the zebra crossing and is unwilling to give up on them. I park my horn in frustration, then silently apologise to the man and each and every one of the stray onions. Let me rewind and explain. Chapter 2. About 10 days ago, I went for a drink after work with a bloke called Brendan. He'd been asking to meet up for ages and I'd run out of excuses. He works for a private investigators company, Cityside Investigations, who are a client of the firm of solicitors where I've been employed these past 2 years. I don't know him that well, but we always have a little chat when he's in the office to pick up documents and flirt with the secretaries. He's about 10 years older than me, skinny and short with wavy side-parted hair that gives him a slightly Tudor edge. He usually wears a blue or grey sports jacket with a beige turtleneck and deep blue A-line denim jeans that sit slightly high above his pointy brown leather shoes. A hint of novelty sock is always deliberately on offer. His face is plain looking, his nose a bit thin and sharp, the overall effect being that of a rolled oat. Yes, a very oaty look that I often associate with Yorkshire squaddies. Brendan thinks of himself as a fun character, and he probably is if you like the company of loud blokes. He talks non-stop and uses laughter as a form of punctuation. It doesn't matter that he hasn't said or attempted to say anything amusing, he still lets out a snigger or a Tommy titter every third sentence or so. He seems to have little interest in what others say to him. I often think it must be nice to believe that your company entrances people. It must be a great confidence builder. I'm always willing to play along with his witterings, and in return he thinks I like him. I don't dislike him, but that's about as far as I would go. I texted him as I finished work and told him I would be at my local pub, the Grove Tavern in Camberwell, around 7 p.m. When I arrived, I noticed a colourful red and white striped bicycle leant up against the wall by the entrance. It crossed my mind that there might be a pissed juggler inside the building, throwing his skittles willy-nilly at the light fittings. I would enjoy watching the repercussions of that sort of incident. When I walked inside, there was no juggler, but I immediately spotted Brendan sat at the bar scrolling through his phone. He didn't see me. There were a few other people seated around, but generally it was quiet and welcoming. The bar takes up one side of the room, and on the opposite side are a series of curved booths with bench seats and backs upholstered in a burgundy velveteen material. A quick thought passed through my mind. What a good name for a pudding, velveteen would be. Would you be interested in a pudding, sir? Yeah, maybe. What have you got? We have a chocolate and orange velveteen served with clotted cream. I'm not saying no to that, mate. It sounds very influential. I'll take one. Then I remembered that I have little interest in puddings, let alone their manufacture, so dropped the thought onto the floor like a used bus ticket. I sat down next to Brendan and he started to talk. "All right, Gary, what can I get you? The bar is your oyster. Ha-ha! I'll have a pint of IPA, thanks. Ha-ha, barman, a pint of IPA for me soppy mate here. Sorry I'm a bit late, Brendan. I was taking a statement from this bloke at work and he suddenly got a terrible sweat on. Whoa, a perspirer! They can be very egregious. Ha-ha-ha! Yeah, I agree. He seemed to get itchy first, you know, before the sweat kicked in. I wanted to ask if he was okay, but when someone is itching, it feels like a bit of a personal thing to bring it up, so anyway. I could tell from his gaze over my shoulder that he had no interest in my tale. He interrupted without the usual unspoken consent. "Look, Gary, it's fine. Gary, I hadn't even noticed you weren't here, to be honest. Here, listen, I've got a legal question for you. Well, I know I work at a solicitor's, but that's good enough for me. Look, I'm not looking for advice. It's just I came up with what I think is an interesting legal conundrum. So listen up. What do you reckon to this? This morning, right, I was having a coffee on me."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.